Okay, we are going to proceed with the program. The next talk, entitled "Bioinspired Cognitive Architecture of External Memory," will be presented by Karina Jaime. So you will have 15 minutes to present the talk, and after that we proceed to a question answer session.
Hi, my name is Karina Jaime, and I'm going to present the topic "Bioinspired Cognitive Architecture of Episodic Memory." This paper was written by Luis Martin, Karina Jaime, Felix Ramos, and Francisco. Episodic memory is the ability to perform, to retrieve or re-experience events that we have. Thanks to this ability, we are able to create plans and decision making, and improve and learn. For that reason, this ability is very important. We are trying to develop a virtual creature that has a human-like behavior. The problem with the current proposal is that they don't include a lot of dynamics, like button up or forgetting. They don't include these abilities to their models. For that reason, we propose an architecture that supports multiple inputs, includes different memory dynamics like forgetting, and is based on neuroscience evidence, and is a distributed system. So all the system is implemented using different processes. The last 50 years, a lot of research groups have developed cognitive architectures using different approach. The idea of the cognitive architecture is so we can endow the creatures with human-like behavior. In this section, we analyze different cognitive architectures that contain some type of episodic memory or that's similar to episodic memory. For example, SOAR is an architecture that is that helps reasoning, planning, execution. The SOAR architecture has a lot of episodes with timestamps. So thanks to this, we are able to retrieve previous following episodes. The thing with SOAR is that they don't have like a specific episodic memory or forgetting, they don't have forgetting. iCube is an open system, 53 freedom degree humanoid. This humanoid, this system stores the memory image. When a new image arrives to the system, it compares this image with the stored ones. If the image is similar to other, it retrieves the similar image. If not, it will encode this new image and store. Then we have the ACTR. ACTR is a cognitive architecture. The idea of ACTR is understand the human cognition. ACTR has a unit of memory named chunks. These chunks includes facts or meanings. It's similar to the idea of episodic memory, but it doesn't have a specific episodic memory. Then we have Libra. This architecture is trying to emulate cognition. Also have a lot of scenes, timestamp. Lida has a declarative memory system that splits between autobiographic and semantic information. So similar to episodic, but doesn't have like a specific episodic memory. Clarion is an architecture that is inspired in psychology, so doesn't have brain areas, but it has definition of episodes that have timestamps. So as I mentioned before, this proposal is based on biological evidence. So this is how we work. We work with model. First, we identify all the brain structures that have some tasks related to episodic memory. Here, you can see that we have all the areas related to episodic memory, then we identify the relationship between them. For example, which one is the input of the other? Then, okay, now we know that they belong to, they have two episodic memory functions, the relationships, the order of flow, and then we try to add another classification to this structure. For example, in this case, we identify the structure that helps with the process of the stimulus, the episodic, the one that are focused on the episodic memory, the one that helps with working memory, and the one that helps with the process of the stimulus, and other structures. Okay, now that we identify the structures, here, for example, and now we identify the task that each of these structures help. For example, we have the visual system. The visual system is a set of brain areas that helps with the identification of object features. It's out of the scope of this paper, but in theory, this helps us to acquire information from the environment. And in this model, we use the visual system to capture the image and also stream it. Then we move to the parietal cortex. The parietal cortex helps us with the stimuli processing. So that means it takes the information that we have for the environment and it segments the data. It helps us with the prehippocampal cortex to identify the amount of objects that we have, the location that where they are belong, the location like values x, j, and these values are from the center of the image. So now that we have, okay, we know the amount of objects, the location of them, we use structures like ITC or inferior temporal cortex. This structure helps us to, okay, we know there is something, an object. Now we need to know the class or the category of this object. So for example, we can know it, oh, it's a bunny, a ball, or something. So this structure, after we send like the main features, it will identify the object and it will reply with the class that it belongs. Then we have the parietal cortex. The parietal cortex helps us. It's the first one that helps with the episodic memory. This will help us to create a relationship between the objects. For example, if we have two objects in the scene, that means that they have some kind of relationship. So we will store this relationship in the system. So in the future, if we see one, if we identify one of these objects, we can recall or retrieve the other one because we know that at some point they work together. The parietal cortex also helps us with their it's an object getaway, gateway, sorry. Gateway, it means that it helps us send information with one area to the other one. And then we have the internal cortex and subiquium. These two areas also are getaways. These areas in particular have another task for other memories, like semantic, prefrontal cortex. But in this case, only help us to send information to one. Then we have the hippocampal areas. The hippocampal areas help us with the encoding, the creation of the scenes, the relationship between the scenes, retrieval of them. And one of the areas between the hippocampal cortex is the digit or the tattoos here. This one helps us create a pattern that will help us and store this in the visual capturing. So we have the stream or information that we have for the visual system. And then thanks to areas like dentatus gyrus, we can store this information in the brain. So we can restore it later. Then we have CA3. CA3 also help us to create, to assign a pattern to the scene that we are having, and also with the retrieval. That means that when we are trying to retrieve episode, we have a part of a pattern, we can use this part or to find similarities in other episodes, and then we can return. CR1 help us to create association or relationships between multiple scenes. Thanks to this ability, we can create plans because we know that this scene or this episode always happens before one or after all. So we can create like a relationship between them. And also help us with the storage of this episode. Then we have the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex main abilities or tasks are related to the working memory. One thing that I forgot to mention is that memory is usually they split the memory in different systems, so it's easier to study and implement. Majority they are very connected, so they are very interacting all the time. So for example, here the prefrontal cortex help us to store current episodes that we are needing in this time for a short period of time. Also help us store key objects or information that we need to restore episodes. Also keeps help us to store the information enough time so we can create the relationship and our things that we need for the other areas. As you can see, we have a lot of modules that are working together. Each one is some, we can see them as a process that are interacting. The way that they interact is we package each package, we name them spikes. These spikes contain information related to the information that we want to send, right? The spikes can contain object names, object class, relationships, communication. Relationship between scenes or a sequence of scenes. Here we have, okay, now the information is running. The episode memory has three main flows. The first one is encoding or storage process. In this process, all the information that we are getting from the environment, we took the information and we create the patterns, we add classes and relationships, all related to encode and store. Then we have the bottom-up. Here is when the brain is, or the model is trying to recollect or retrieve information that is related to the things that we are getting from the environment. So that's the agent is not trying to recollect this information. It's a natural function. So we are getting all the related information. We store that in the working memory just in case that we need that for acting or for any decision. It's just in case. And then we have the top-down approach. In the top-down approach, the agent is trying to recollect or retrieve information. So it tries to recollect information that is not part of the thing that we are getting from the environment. So we have this external input that is stored in the working memory. Then we use this as a keyword to recollect it. The implementation is two layers. The first one is a unity model where we are getting, where we have all the objects and scenes and the virtual creature. Then we have a Python layer. This Python layer is a perception system that helps us identify the main features of the objects that are in the environment. And then we have a middleware. This middleware is implemented by the research group. This middleware tries to, each brain area is like a server that has a lot of services. The services are the tasks that are doing the episodic memories. We have two test case studies. The first one, we are trying to test only the memory. Here, the virtual creature. We put the virtual creature in an environment. So first, the creature is trying to learn the environment, the objects, so the relationship between everything. Then we put the same virtual creature in the same environment. The idea is to see if the creature is able to recognize that, well, I have been here before, so I don't need to store this again. I don't need to because I already know this. And the third phase is when we ask the virtual creature to find or recollect information related to one object that was in the environment. So here we're trying to see if they is able to recollect as we expect. Second scenario, we have 9 rooms. Each room has different locations and objects. The creature needs first try to learn, identify the objects in each room and the location of each one. And then, okay, again, we leave the creature in the same place. We try to see if it's able to identify things, recollect, and reduce the amount of encoding and storage. The results of the first experiment, we noticed that the creature is able to first retrieve scenes. Then we play with the similarity threshold. First we use a .5, and with this one recollects around 19 different scenes. So similarities. And then we increase the threshold to .8. In .8 only defines one scene. So the one that we are actually and the second experiment, first the agent is learning everything. And in this scene, we also ask the agent to find a specific room and starting from another room. So the creator needs to find or identify the steps needed to move one to the other. He already knows. The results here is that the agent is able to list all the scenes that help move from one scene to another. The execution plan, it's the action needed to move from one to the other. And then the reduced execution plan is when identifies the system identifies that has multiple execution steps. So they reduce the duplicates and has the better smooth. With the results, we are able to say that we have an episodic memory model that can encode, store, retrieve, and forget. It can create multiple scenes and object relationships. Information can be general or specific, and the outputs can be used in another functions like planning. We noticed that because we are using only 2 layers, we have a lot of ambiguities. That for that reason, we need to identify the need for more brain areas. These brain areas will help us create more information. This information could be more specific, so we can reduce ambiguity. And we need to combine with more complex functions like decision making or attention and motivation, so we can have goals, different goals. In conclusion, this is a base on psychological and neuroscientific evidence. It's a modular and distributed system. That means it can work by itself or it can be part of a distributed system. It's useful for multidisciplinary domains. That means we can help, games, or we can understand the human cognition, and it's part of architecture. But thanks to Conasi for the financial support, and thank
you. Any question?
Hi. I was wondering, when we talk about episodes, there are the beginning of an episode, the episode takes some time to happen, and then at some point it stops. How do you make this transition from the beginning to the end? Do you have ways for detecting when an episode is starting or when an episode is finishing?
We use timestamps and identifier. So we know which one is the first one and the next one has the next identifier, right? That's the way we are at least identifying that one is before the other, the timestamp and identifiers. And when we know that something starts or finish, it's more like what we are looking for. In this point, for us, when we are retrieving by objects. So for example, maybe the first four scenes doesn't include the object that we are looking for, so we are not including it. We are including since the object is present and also the object is present. When the object disappears, at this point of the architecture, everything is related to the object and its relationships.
I have a question.
How do you deal with something that has intrigued psychology and cognitive neuroscience for decades, that is, especially in this kind of memory, that is the repression of the memory, not the forgetting, but the repression. I can't remember, not because I forget, because later on I will remember when I'm older, for example. But then in that stage of my life, I can recall something because I repress it.
In this model in particular, we are not including things like motivation, attention, or emotions. And in this case, when we include them, since the beginning now, we start with the memory model, we use the approach that we have always information, but we lost the connections. So the information is always there, but we lost the connection. When we're forgetting, we lost connection. So when we retrieve something that is pretty, very difficult to find, like compress. Memory, it's because a lot of things combine at the same time. So when we are retrieving, it's the only one with the textbook. So it's the worst thing. But we need to have a lot of things at the same time. So right now, the idea is to add the episodic nervous promotions to this approach. So when we store this in the episode, it will include the feeling that that has in the same time. So when we also can retrieve the episode by the feeling, so not just by the objects. And another thing is because we are implementing the forgetting, it's when we retrieve the episode, each time that we retrieve, we are going to reduce the threshold, so it will be difficult to find. But it's just a number that each time that I use it, I will reduce or modify also. Because maybe when the first time that I stored the episode, that was pretty sad, the second time I was like, eh. So maybe the model set will be reduced. So the next time when I'm very sad, maybe it's not going to be my first option.
Another question? Okay.
Is there a software available that we can have access to have a better understanding of how this works? And is it possible to have access to this software?
Yes. The way that is implemented is because it's a distributed system. We have the middleware. And we have the definition of each area. So yes, you can access it. Yes, I think, I don't know where it is, but the token. But yeah, yes, so since the Unity, how to install the Unity, the to perception, and then the middleware. That also helps. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Karina, for your presentation.